Good morning. It is wonderful to be in person here saying good morning. And in the name of the God who has the capacity to surprise and delight us, I welcome you to worship this morning at First Presbyterian Church of Rockwall. Our opening sentence of scripture this morning is from the prophet Nehemiah, chapter 8, verse 10. This day is holy to our Lord, and do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. As I said, I'm overjoyed to be able to be praising God with you in this room and with all of you who are out there watching online right now. You're going to notice a few differences today. Those of you who are watching online, we have a mounted camera now, so you're not going to get all the close-ups and the lighting that you got because, in all honesty, we didn't want people tripping over cables as they walked in today. We decided that that would be a bad thing, so please bear with us on that. But you're going to be sharing the exact same worship experience that those in the room are having. If you're on Facebook, and later in the day, we will be posting on YouTube as quickly as we can in the afternoon. As has become our custom, if you're worshiping online and you have prayer requests, please post them on our Facebook feed so that the community can hold those who are dear to your heart in their prayers. For those of you in the room, just a quick reminder that we're not passing anything today. The offering plate is outside. You picked up bulletins on your way in, or you can watch them on your phone because they've been emailed out and are available on the Facebook feed as well. We will wish one another Christ's peace as a group. We won't be moving around the sanctuary. There will be no congregational singing. Thank you, Mary and Ike, for being here to be our singers today. And when they're singing, you're welcome to look at the words that are printed there for their responses and for the hymn, and just meditate along prayerfully with them for that. After worship, we ask that you remain in your seats and our ushers will guide you out and will exit through the main sanctuary doors. I have an announcement today that the ALS walk will be October 31st, and if you're interested in participating or supporting the Kirk clan, please see our October church newsletter or contact Mary Kirk for details. I'd like to tell everyone that our anthem today, How Great Thou Art, is being sung in memory of Tom Moore, a member of this church who died on October 7th. And I ask you to please continue to keep Aaron Adams and the rest of the Moore family in our prayers. Today is the third Sunday of the month. We will be taking up our offering in support of Helping Hands in the food pantry there. You can write us a check, or you can give online at our website, www.firstpresrockwall.org. It's also Birthday Sunday, so check the back of your bulletin or check online if you were emailed that. And happy birthday to everyone who was born in October. We are delighted to be able to celebrate with you today. I want to give a special thanks today to David Gordon, Erica Nannis, and to Kevin Logue, who have been here faithfully, week in, week out, making sure that worship has happened here by manning our AV crew. And so can we give them some applause? A special thank you to the Monday Morning Group for getting the sanctuary in order for today's service. And it was quite a job. Let me tell you, all those cables had to go away somewhere. And I want to thank our elders for being here today to implement the procedures they adopted for returning to in-person worship and the task group that came up with those procedures. Can we give all of those a round of applause as well? Finally, I thank all of you for your participation, for your cooperation, and for your patience as we move into this new way of being. And now I invite you to breathe in, welcome the Spirit's presence. Let us worship God.
Thank you.
Today we face a test, because today we step out in faith, gathering in person for the first time in 7 months. We come together trusting that God's Spirit is in our midst. We come together trusting the elders of this church are doing the most loving thing for the greatest number of people, at both reopening this sacred space and continuing to care for those who are worshiping remotely. Today, we strive to remember that no matter what, no matter how we're tested, we are one people, the very body of Christ, bound together in God's love. Because the church is not this building. The church is God's people. Today, in our scripture, we'll encounter Jesus being tested by the authorities. Jesus responds to this test in a way that may surprise you. And I ask, how do we respond to the tests we face? Can we channel Jesus' spirit in our civic life?
We come here to encounter the teachings of Jesus. Many wanted to destroy him for these teachings. And sometimes we too find that his words challenge us, calling us to more than we think we can be or do. Forgive us, O God. Let us be shaped into a new people, made in the mold of justice, not the stamp of Caesar's coin. You entered our story through Jesus. Now help us to enter fully into the story of your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. Know this, there are people whose lives have been changed completely by God's story of love and passion. Transformation is possible. You are forgiven and freed, encouraged and loved by God, by a God who wants you to live fully. Rejoice, for in Jesus Christ you are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
As noted earlier, we will not be passing the peace this morning. Those of you at home will be treated to a short video wishing you Christ's peace.
Hello from the McShanes. We are hoping that each and every one of you are staying safe and healthy, and we are looking forward to fellowshipping with everyone in person very soon.
The peace of Christ to everyone.
Let us pray. Majestic God, help us to feel and see your presence in our lives. Enable us to listen clearly to your words. Encourage us to go into your world, serving others and bringing your message of mercy and love. In Jesus' name, we pray. Being tested was nothing new for Jesus. During his ministry, he was faced time and again with situations in which he was asked to defend his teachings against the way we've always done it. I invite you to turn in your Bibles to the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 22, verses 15 through 22, as we open ourselves up to God's word this morning. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us, then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. The word of the Lord.
God, when I in awesome wonder
Thank you, Mary and Ike. Thank you, Dan. Today's scripture presents a face of Jesus that we don't explore very often, if at all. Jesus as trickster. Now, many of you are probably familiar with trickster characters. Maybe you read the stories of Brer Rabbit as a child. I know we have at least one member who is well-versed in the coyote stories of the Native Americans. What you may not realize is that the trickster is a venerated archetype in Jewish lore. The schnorrer, for example, is one who, although a poor underdog, survives and even thrives through his or her cleverness. Even the Hebrew Bible is chock full of trickster characters. Abram and Sarai, before they were Abraham and Sarah, they travel to Egypt, where Abram saves his own life by tricking a smitten Pharaoh into thinking that Sarai was his sister instead of his wife. Things did not go well for Sarai. Abraham and Sarah's son, Isaac, is tricked by his wife, Rebekah, and her younger son, Jacob, into bestowing the blessing that was due the eldest son onto Jacob, who also tricks his brother Esau into giving up his birthright inheritance, all for a bowl of stew. But Jacob is then tricked into marrying not one, but two sisters, as his uncle Laban, Rebekah's brother, cleverly gets 14 years' work, double the labor, out of Jacob in return for the hand of the one sister that he desired, Rachel. And Rachel, in turn, tricks her father, Laban, out of his valuable household idols when she, Jacob, and her sister Leah leave town. What a soap opera! And yet, all of these people are lifted up as heroes of the faith. Yeah, but Jesus? Really? Are we ready to go there? Our passage starts with a group of Pharisees and Herodians coming together to entrap Jesus. And this in itself is odd because the Pharisees are devoted to the temple and the Herodians are devoted to keeping Herod on the throne, a throne that he got from Rome. And they hate each other, but they hate Jesus more because as we've seen again and again and again, Jesus is an unsettling influence, always pushing God's agenda and not the agenda of those in power. They start by laying on the compliments. Oh, Jesus, you're such a great teacher, so sincere. You don't play favorites. You tell it like it is. And then they stick in the knife with a simple question designed to bring Jesus down. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not? Well, later in the New Testament, as we talked about a few weeks ago, Paul, Peter, and other writers make it clear that part of being a Christian is being a good citizen, and that includes paying taxes. But this question, at this particular time, is a setup. If Jesus answers yes, he's saying that he supports Rome, because taxes paid to Rome fund the occupation of Palestine. With a yes answer, Jesus will lose the followers who are shouting, "Hosanna, save us," as he entered Jerusalem on that day that we call Palm Sunday. With a no answer, Rome is going to come down on him like a ton of bricks. Something that Jesus wasn't ready for yet. So he calls them out as a bunch of hypocrites. He's on to their games. And then he goes into trickster mode. And quietly, almost nonchalantly, he asks them for a coin. But not just any coin. He asks them for one of the coins used to pay the tax. It's a denarius, which has a picture of the emperor on one side, and in that day and time, it would have been an engraving of Tiberius, and it would have read, from the Latin, "Caesar Augustus Tiberius, son of the divine," and on the reverse side, it would have said, "High priest." Now, your Bible radar should be going off right about now. The guy on the coin was called the Son of God and declared to be a high priest. Sound familiar? It should, because those are titles that we use for Jesus. Titles meant to make a clear distinction between the overreaching powers of this world and the power of Christ. Anyway, the search for a coin itself should provide some comic relief to readers of that day, because holy people like the Pharisees, they couldn't be seen with coins with graven images like Roman emperors. That would break the second commandment against idols, which Deanna Hollis touched on last week. And the Herodians, who didn't mind paying taxes, still wouldn't want to be seen in the temple with such a coin. You know the old joke that Protestants don't recognize the Pope, Unitarians don't recognize the Trinity, and nobody recognizes anyone else in the liquor store? Well, I can just imagine both sides digging around in their purses for a coin and pretending not to see the other ones come up with one. So just by asking for that coin, Jesus' trickster side is coming out. But then he answers their question with another question, a riddle. "Whose head's on this coin?" he asks, lifting it up. "Whose title?" According to Tom Thacker, author of Jesus the Riddler, when Jesus asks the riddle, be prepared to be stumped. You're only going to be able to answer it if he provides you with an answer. No one in Scripture figures out Jesus' puzzles on their own. And when Jesus answers a riddle, it's game over. He shuts down the conversation, which he does here. By holding up the coin and asking the obvious question about who's on the coin, he gives them the answer. The emperor, of course. But then he goes on to provide his own answer to their question. Give to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and give to God the things that are God's. Drop the mic, rap battle over. You know, people often ask why Jesus couldn't just come out and say things clearly, in black and white. But let's face it, we wouldn't still be talking about this incident if Jesus hadn't been a bit of a trickster, cleverly putting off the hour when he would indeed be turned over by the temple leadership and executed by Rome. But his hour hadn't come yet, so Jesus takes this opportunity to get everybody thinking, including us, more than 2,000 years later. Jesus's simple yet complex comment, it has staying power. You know, everyone listening that day went home pondering, you know, what belongs to the state? What belongs to God? And how do I know the difference? I'm hoping that you're thinking about these questions right now. Exodus chapter 9, verse 29 reads, "The earth is the Lord's." And this is expanded upon on Psalm 24, verse 1. "The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it." In summary, it all belongs to God. And we know this because God created it. God redeemed it all in Christ, and God sustains it all by the presence of his Holy Spirit. Our responsibility, then, is to work with God and the state to ensure justice and peace. Because, as author Amy Jill Levine says, paying everything to God is not going to create safe roads or provide protection from marauding gangs or bring food to starving people. So we pay our taxes. We pay our taxes, and in this election season, we'll vote to select leaders who share our views on how those taxes are spent. Most importantly, we look to God in Christ to shape our views, because ultimately, it does all belong to God. But make no mistake, we render what is theirs to the powers of this world only up to the point where our obedience would put us into conflict with our moral responsibility as children of God, at which point we're called to take a stand. And when we make that stand, we take a risk, just like Jesus. It's a fine line to walk, but we have a great role model, Jesus, the trickster. Amen.
As you are able, as we say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. We do many things with our money. We support our family, we pay our taxes, we give to the church, to Helping Hands, and to other causes that make this world more like the kingdom of God. This morning, I invite you to give thanks for all that you have been given, remembering that it is all God's. And in offering thanks, I invite you to give yourself to God and to God's work of reconciliation. And you may be seated. Will you pray with me? God, it does our hearts good to know that Jesus had a little bit of trickster in him. He knew what was important, and he was willing to use everything he had, even that trickster part, to convey your will. Help us to use our faith, our intellect, and our civic identity to foster your kingdom of love, justice, and mercy as we move further into this election season and beyond. We pray for this country that we may turn away from the divisiveness that has separated us and look for ways to come together to be good citizens of your kingdom and this secular state. As we look for ways to actively support your platform of peace, we turn to you for support, for strength, and for intervention in those areas we entrust to you this day. We rejoice that you hear us as we pray for all who continue to be impacted by COVID-19, especially those who have lost loved ones and who struggle against the virus and its lingering effects. We pray, Lord, for your church, the people, not the building, that you will keep us safe and well, even as we work to keep others safe and well by obeying both civil laws and your law of love. We pray for justice to flow down like water and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream as we struggle to give voice and practice to your will in the world, even in the midst of those who would tempt and trick us. And we pray for those dear to our hearts, Lord, for Aaron Adams and all those who grieve the death of Tom Moore, for Leon Tuttle as he recovers from surgery, for Ken Strack, his wife Sherry, and their family, for Gordon and Marie Breland, for Lynn Ward, who's awaiting back surgery, for Kelly Smith's mother, Linda James, and her aunt, Loretta Warren. We celebrate today with the Dobbs family, the marriage of Laura and Shelby Verdon, and we share the joy of the Tunnel family, who have welcomed a new grandbaby, Lincoln Benavides, into this your world. God, we know we will be tested as Jesus was tested. Bolster our faith, build up our resolve that we may respond well in words and action, to your glory and the glory of your Son, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You know, hearing today's text, I'm reminded of a saying that John Williams coined for the activators at Austin College. God gave you a brain and expects you to use it. Jesus used all of his wits to bring about the kingdom of heaven. May we do the same. And now, may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and in all the days to come. Go in peace to love and serve our risen Lord. Amen.